I'm at Harpers Ferry, West Virginia. This is the train depot. And over there on the other side of the Potomac River is Maryland Heights. That's where we're going to be hiking today. There's an old Civil War fort up there at the top. And I'm also going to look for some old historic survey benchmarks. Just stopped in here for a second to show you what the inside of the old train depot looks like here at Harpers Ferry. I don't have a wide angle on this camera, so I have to move the lens around a little bit to show you. There's a couple people outside waiting for trains, but here's what the inside looks like. A nice old train depot. This land down here next to the Potomac River is where the United States Armory was. There's some stone foundations down there and some leftover pieces from water-powered machinery and so forth. The nation's armory was once here. Here's a 360 pan of this area. Over there is the Harpers Ferry train depot, and that's where I parked. You have to pay a fee to park there, but I got in for free on my senior pass because I'm old. Over here is the Potomac River, and this land down there is where the United States Armory was. Across the river up there, that's Maryland Heights. That's where we're going to go hiking. That's the Potomac River. Over there is Virginia and Loudoun Heights. And then you're starting to see some of the buildings here. Harpers Ferry. It's a pretty steep, the terrain here is pretty steep, so everything's built kind of in the side of the mountain. And back to the train depot. This is the John Brown Monument. This marks the spot where John Brown's fort which was the Federal Armory fire engine house where it once stood. It's been moved maybe 100 yards away, right down there. That's where it is now. Not sure why they moved it, but well, where it once was is covered with dirt, and train tracks are up here, so maybe that's why they moved it. But anyway, it's down there now. Here's a look at John Brown's fort where it stands now, and it once was up on top of that hill there where that monument is. I'm right at the point of Harpers Ferry. This is the Shenandoah River. Looking upstream just a little ways. And here's where it flows into the Potomac River. Right here. And that's looking downstream towards Washington, D.C. This is part of the Appalachian Trail here at Harpers Ferry, and we're going to be going up here and across this bridge, across the Potomac River over into Maryland, and then up to Maryland Heights. Still on the footbridge crossing the Potomac River. And over that way is the Shenandoah River. And here's looking downstream.
straight above it, I think.
I'm on the Maryland side of the Potomac now, and this is part of the C&O Canal. That's looking downstream towards Washington, D.C. This is lock number 33, what's left of it. But there's the canal, and up there is the entrance to the lock. Here's a little closer look at the entrance to the lock. Up there is the ruins of what I assume is a lock keeper's house. And right there's the entrance going into the lock. I'm standing at the entrance to lock 33. I'm on the downstream side, looking upstream towards Cumberland, Maryland. And here's what it looks like standing in the entrance to the lock. I'm about 1.1 miles into my hike. So far, all I've really done is cross over the Potomac River into Maryland and hike along this C&O Canal. I'm standing on the towpath. There's the canal. This section of the canal is in pretty good shape. It's probably been restored some. And we're gonna cross over the canal on this little bridge. And then we're heading up into the mountains, up into Maryland Heights. Here's what the rest of the C&O towpath looks like here. And for now, we're going across this bridge and heading up into the mountains. This is the first naval battery. This is stop number 3 on the National Park Service map. It was built in 1862, and it had 2 9-inch Dahlgren naval guns and 1 50-pounder. Of course, all these trees would have been cut down back then, so they would have a better view of the surroundings. Here's the intersection with the old military road. This is the old road that would have been here during the Civil War times. It goes up the side of the mountain until we finally get up to the ridge line and the old stone fort. So here we go. I'm on a really steep section of this military road here. I'm gonna say it's about a 45 degree slope. Here's head looking uphill. Here's part of it going downhill. Man, I can't imagine getting those big Navy guns up the side of this mountain. That must have been unbelievably hard. Wow. Whew. Could barely get myself up this road. In case you didn't read that sign that I included in the video, I'm still on this really steep section of this road, and that sign down there says that the guns they hauled up here weighed 9,700 pounds apiece. Wow. I'm still going up this incredibly steep military road, but this is stop number 5. This is a charcoal hearth. This leveled out area here is where they would cut down wood and stack it and cover it up and light it and let it burn for about 10 days and it would turn itself into charcoal. The piece of paper I have says there's about 50 of these built up here in the mountain. I'm up high on the ridgeline now. The elevation here is about 1,350 feet, about 3 miles into the hike. And up here you can see stoneworks like this one here. I've seen some depressions and so forth. We're not at the fort yet, but starting to see evidence of fortifications up here. This is a stone wall, defensive fighting positions, I guess, for the people that lived up here in this fort. There's a sign that says this wall extends down the side of the mountain here about 500 feet. And there's two of these walls. This one's the south side, and there's another one, I guess, up on the north side. For now, we're going to head up that way and go up a real steep embankment to get up to where the actual fort is. Finally made it to the summit. This is the beginning of the interior of the fort. I just crossed this stone wall here. Right back there is where the trail comes through the stone wall. There's part of the stone wall here. And the stone wall extends on down that way to the left of the trail. And then all this area in through here, all this in through here is where the fort was. And the stone building is over that way somewhere. I haven't gotten there yet. For now, we're going to go this way and see what else they have on the tour. Looking over this way, there's a 9 foot high dirt embankment that was built to protect the north end of the fort. And over here in the opposite direction is a big hole in the ground right there. Let me walk over here. And this was one of the powder magazines that was up here. There's a big hole in the dirt here, which would have been powder magazine, and it would have been covered over with a shed, and then that would have been covered up with dirt probably. That's the north wall of the old stone fort. I'm gonna go up there and I'll get some pictures and video, and I'm gonna eat lunch and look for some old historic survey benchmarks, which are supposed to be a little south of the south end of the fort. So we'll see what we can find up here. I'm standing on what's left of the old stone fort. I'm standing on the north wall. It's a pretty substantial structure. The walls here, here's the wall I'm standing on right here. And gosh, it looks like it might be eight feet thick, stacked stones. There's a trail I came up on. There's a little piece of the wall that hadn't totally collapsed to give you some idea what the stonework looked like. There's a little bit of a view towards Maryland over there, but not much. All these trees, of course, would have been cut down during the Civil War. With just a little bit of view that I do have, I can see that you could see for quite a ways from up here. There's another one of the walls there. There's a sign down there. We'll go down there and see what that says. And down that way is the south end of the fort. And here's the north wall again. And just down there, a couple hundred feet, are those powder magazines. Well, the holes that were where the powder magazines were. Here's the stone fort from a different view. I'll do a 360 pan. That's the north wall there. A lot of trees have grown up here now. Over there's the stone fort. I'm just a little bit south of the stone fort now, looking for these survey benchmarks, and look what I found right there. That's the triangulation station. It's marked Maryland Heights, 1869, 1957. That's one of the original survey points when they did the original East Coast survey authorized by Thomas Jefferson. And looking around, I see over there, on top of that boulder there, one of the reference marks. I see another reference mark over there. And there should be another reference mark over this way somewhere. I'll have to search for that one. There's reference mark number one. It's stamped Maryland Heights, number one, 1927. And the arrow is pointing over to the triangulation station, which is on that rock with my paintbrush. There's reference mark number three. It's marked Maryland Heights, 1869, 1957. And the arrow's pointing over there to the triangulation station, which is just to the right of my day pack. Okay, well, after some considerable searching, I found this one. This is reference mark number four. It's marked Maryland Heights, 1869, number four, 1957. And the arrow points back to the triangulation station, which is way back there, about 65 feet away. Okay, just to summarize all the survey marks that are up here, there's the stone fort right there. And right there is the triangulation station for Maryland Heights. Over there is reference mark number one. And over there is reference mark number three. And way over there, right about where that trail takes a bend to the right, where those bright colored rocks are, right behind there, is reference mark number four. And then back around to the triangulation station. This is the location of a 30-pound battery. This is a little lower down on the mountain than the big 100-pounder. We're at about 1,150 feet here. There's a ditch. There's the breastworks, the earthenworks. Now, if we come up this ramp, there's a big flattened-out area where the guns were. And back there, that second vertical pole back there says powder magazine. So there was a powder magazine back there too. And there's a ramp coming up here and the trail going on down the side of the mountain. So this is where they had the 30 pounders. Here's a view from the overlook, looking down at Harpers Ferry. The elevation here is about 600 feet. Here's the Potomac River looking upstream. And there's Harpers Ferry, the Shenandoah River, and up there's Loudoun Heights, and that way is the Potomac River downstream. Okay, well, to get back to Harpers Ferry train depot from this overlook, there's two ways. One is step off those rocks, and the other way back is hiking a half a mile up the side of this mountain to get back to the main trail. I guess for now I'm going to head on up the side of the mountain. Okay, finally made it back up to the main trail. We've got to, it's about 2 miles from here back to Harpers Ferry. That white blaze trail goes up to the summit where the fort is, where the stone fort is. I just came from that direction. That's from the overlook, about a half a mile down the side of the mountain. And we're gonna go this way, which is down and off the side of the mountain. Okie dokie, there's the trailhead. I finally got down off the side of the mountain. There's the road, and we're going across that bridge. Taking a left, and we'll be walking downstream the Potomac River there for a while on the towpath, and then we'll cross over back into Harpers Ferry, West Virginia. We're back to lock number 33 on the C&O Canal. And way up there is the overlooks where we just came from.